And amen, amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. We're sorry for being a little late getting started, but as you know, we were doing our drive-through communion outside, and then when we came in, the computer kind of went down, and you know, difficulties. Satan don't want God's program to go on, but in spite of it all, we're moving right ahead. Amen. So we get ready to start our worship service at this time, and we want to say we're going to have first of all our scripture that's going to be read by Michelle. And then the prayer will be done by Minister LaShawn Callion. And then the Psalms 100 will be by Deacon Callion. Amen. Amen. And then we'll come back after that. Amen.
Amen. Bless the Lord on today. Bless the Lord. Amen. Thank you for the word of God. The word of God comes from 1 Peter, first chapter, second verse. God the Father knew you and chose you long ago, and his Spirit has made you holy. And as a result, you have obeyed him and have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. May God give you more and more grace and peace. Amen. Bless the readers and the hearers and the doers of the mighty word of God. Amen. Father God, as we come before you,
yes, God,
we come just to say, Lord, we thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you for this day, oh God, the day that you have opened up our eyes on another day to give you glory and to give you praise. Father God, let us receive you. Let us receive this word, oh Lord. Let it come straight from the heavens. Allow your people's hearts and minds and ears to be opened up to what the Spirit of the Lord has to say. Lord, as you do new things in this earth, oh God, do new things in your people, Lord. Let us be able and willing to receive what you are doing in our lives, oh God. And when we don't understand, Lord, let us lean not to our own understanding. But in all our ways, Lord, let us acknowledge you. Oh, you are the Alpha and the Omega. Lord, you don't care about what's going on in the world, Lord. You told us to move in wisdom. So, Father God, as we lean not to our own understandings, Lord, let us always look to the hills that we come at our help. Because all our help comes from the Lord. So, Father God, we gather on this day, a day that you have made, a day unlike no other. For all things are made new in you, oh God. So Lord, let your people begin to receive a fresh anointing. Let your people begin to receive your Spirit in ways that they've never received it before. Let us not worry about what the politicians say and what the government may say. Because Lord, you are always in control. You have been in control and you will continue to be in control. So Lord, we say thank you for this day. Open our mouths, oh Lord, with the word from you, oh God, that we may speak life into situations, oh God, that the enemy might have told us are dead. But Lord, we know that in your word there is life. So Father God, we thank you for breathing your breath of life in us today, oh God. Let us do something different today than we did yesterday. Let us see you and feel you differently today than we did yesterday. Father God, let your word fall on us, oh God. Let your anointing fall, oh God. And break the yokes, oh God. You said your word will break strongholds, oh Lord. So Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Lord. We thank you and we honor you, oh God. For you are worthy of all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. So Father God, we just want to thank you on this day. We want to acknowledge the fact that you are God. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
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 Glory, glory, glory.
Amen. Amen. Come on,
saints. Hallelujah, Lord.
Please repeat after me, Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye land.
Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye land.
Serve the Lord with gladness.
Serve the Lord with gladness.
Come before his presence with singing.
Come before his presence with singing.
Know ye that the Lord, he is God.
Know ye that the Lord, he is God.
It is he who hath made us.
It is he who hath made us.
And not we ourselves.
And not we ourselves.
We are his people.
We are his people.
And the sheep of his pasture.
And the sheep of his pasture.
Enter into his gates with thanksgiving.
Enter into his gates with thanksgiving.
And into his courts with praise.
And into his courts with praise.
Be thankful unto him.
Be thankful unto him.
Bless his name.
And bless his name.
For the Lord is good.
For the Lord is good.
His mercy is everlasting.
His mercy is everlasting.
And his truth endureth to all generations.
And his truth endureth to all generations.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah,
Jesus.
Amen. Amen. It kind of feels good to be back in the house. Amen. And service a little different than when we were just sitting around the table at home. And today, we got a portion of our praise team that just happened to be outside. And I asked them to linger Amen. So we can do at least a song or two.
Yes, God.
And we're going to do right now. Thank you, Lord. We have so much to be thankful for.
Hallelujah.
We're just asking God and letting Him know that, God, even in the midst of this pandemic, we're still thankful because we know you are in control.
Yes, God.
Amen. So come on and gather around your phone, your radio, your TV,
yes, Lord.
Whatever you're watching us on right now.
Thank you, Lord, today.
And join in with us and begin to thank Him at home. Amen.
Thank you, God.
Come on,
child.
Oh, God, thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Woo.
Tragedy.
church. Slide down. Amen. I want to let you know it's not too late either. If you missed her, give me a communion. Mother Shirley is still outside with the communion table, waiting for you to drive through and pick up your communion. So it ain't too late. Amen. So come on through. Hallelujah. You are my strength. All right, folks, I'm going to be glad you're back in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm going to give you one more song. Thank you, God. Hallelujah.
Strength,
yeah.
Strength like no other.
peace like no other.
Peace like no other.
In the midst of the storm, it reaches. We in the house. We don't mind serving God. Amen. So we just want to say thank you for tuning in and joining in with our worship service on today. And as I said earlier, if you didn't get here in time to get your communion, Mother Shirley is still out there with the communion waiting for you to drive through and pick yours up and just keep on rolling. Amen. We're practicing our social distancing. That's why the mics were so spread apart. With the few praise team members that we did have here, we thank God for them even on today. Amen. I want to say at this time also, happy birthday. It's been a brand new month to all of our May birthdays. Yeah. Amen. And anniversaries. Amen. I know that next Sunday is Cindy Betty's, one of our members. Her birthday is next Sunday. And a few years ago on Mother's Day, which will be next Sunday, she got baptized on that same day on her birthday. What a great birthday gift to give to yourself. And to give yourself away to the Lord. Amen. Amen. So for all May birthdays and celebrations, we want to say happy birthday, happy anniversary. Also for all of our graduates that were supposed to graduate, even those on yesterday, we thank God for them. We have one of our seniors here with us today. Amen. And she's going to come before you in just a little while and give you the gift that God has given her to share with all of us. In such a mighty way, and that's none other than Jaira, who was supposed to graduate yesterday with Lakeshore High. We thank God for her being a part of our family and being here on today. So you'll hear back from Jaira in just a little bit. We thank God for you. And also, we're praying for all of our sick and our recovering. For Sister Linda Griffin, who came through earlier to get her communion. She's having a procedure tomorrow, and she asked that we all make sure to lift her up in prayer. She's getting some treatments done to her back. So we're believing with you, Auntie, that God is going to heal you and that you're going to be just fine. Also still praying for Aunt Olivia Tillerson, for Mother Mildred, Minister Mildred Graham, amen, for her recovery. We thank God that when the doctor went in, came back and found nothing on the mass in her brain. We thank God for that. Still praying for Brother Wesley Waldrop. And as I said, we're praying for Cindy as well, who's going to be celebrating her birthday next Sunday. Also praying still for our out-of-town members, Sister Shirley West, her sons, the Ray, for Tony Seawright, and her sons, Khalil and Kwasim, call them Simi, amen. And also for Barbara Martin in the Bronx, and then for also special prayer we ask it, for Mother Martha Gaskin, who is the mother of our own Andrea Gaskin, who's normally up on the praise team with us. I spoke with Andrea last night. And she said they were admitting her mom to the hospital. She took her in for some tests on yesterday, but they ended up keeping her. And they're running some tests, making sure it's not the COVID-19, and just making sure that she's staying safe. So we're praying for her, because we know it's so hard these days when they are taking our loved ones into the hospital, and they're separating them, and they're alone, and we can't be with them. And so Andrea was just a wreck last night, because everything has moved so fast. And so, Andrew, we're still praying for you, dear, and want you to know God is still in control, man. And don't give up, because God won't give up on you. Amen. Also, still praying for our brother Ed Moffitt, who's the nephew of our Sister Dolly, of our members here at the church. He's in Arkansas. Also, still praying for Latrice Saunders, who is the granddaughter of my pastor. She's still in a coma in Los Angeles. Praying for that family, my God. And just a few months ago, as I told you before, he buried his grandson. And now his granddaughter's in the coma. The devil is mad, especially at the body of Christ.
Yeah.
And so he's trying to do everything that he can to deter us and turn us away from doing what we know God has called us to do. But in spite of it all, we're still going to serve. Amen. Praying for my Aunt Emily Kimbrough in Ypsilanti, Michigan, who had a stroke one last week. She's in the hospital, but she's doing much better by the grace of God.
Amen.
Also praying for, Uncle Bubba, Milton Haynes, his nephew, Kendall, who is doing fine, still doing good. That was a young man that had been in a coma for about 5 weeks, fighting for his life, but he's up, talking, eating, and everything. But God. Amen, amen. Also, Trinise's aunt is home. He gave her a big parade on yesterday. Mother Nordine. We're so glad that she's doing much better. We're also praying. I got a couple of phone calls on yesterday from Brother Dwayne Ginn called me, asked us to be in prayer for his sister, Daphne. She's in stage 4 cancer. And we're asking that you just continue to please lift that family up in prayer. We know that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above anything that we can ask. And he called last night in concern for his sister. And just asking the church, because he knows that Christian love is a church that believes in the power of prayer. Amen. So we're praying for you, Daphne, letting you know that God is still a healer. No matter what it may look like, God is still in control. Also remembering our bereaved families. We prayed last week. We're still praying for Mother Pearl, who lost her cousin, Jim Vills. Praying for him. For Mother Willie Mae Shear's family. That's the Shear family, Karen Gordon, her mother-in-law. They buried her on last week. We're praying for that family still. Friends of ours in Detroit. And also for the young girl, Skylar, who both her parents are first responders. They buried her on last week as well. Still lifting that family up and praying. There's so many folk that are hurting. And so we're just asking God to just send your angels to dispatch around them. And let them know that you still have not forgotten them.
Yeah.
Praying for Trinise and Ed Johnson, for their brother, LJ Sutton, for the Sutton family, and the El Shaddai family. Still praying with y'all. There's just so much going on. We want you to know that no matter what it looked like, our God, the God that we serve, we know he is in control. My God, we thank you, God, for just everything that you've done, all you've done for us. Continue to do. God, we don't understand everything, why it happens. And I've said this before, a lot of us, we're losing our loved ones and not getting a chance to say goodbye. And it kind of reminded me of what the rapture is going to be like. Because God's going to come quick.
Yeah.
And we're not going to have a chance to say goodbye or have a home-going service for you. He said, in a moment of a twinkling of an eye, we shall be caught up to meet him, those that love the Lord. Amen. So we were praying. Still praying for Brother Ed West's family of Collage 3, the young brother that we prayed for a couple of weeks ago. He lost his fight to the battle of COVID-19. So many, we're just praying for you that know that God loves you, and the enemy will come to you and try to make you think God don't care. But that's the time you have to really turn all your focus and your trust in God, believing that he'll do what he said he will do. Amen. We're also asking to remind you to please join us on tomorrow for our 6 p.m. Bible study. That's been going really, really well. We thank God for that, because normally at our Bible study here at the church, we have about 20 to 25 people. On last Monday, we had over 100 people that joined in to view with our Bible study. God is doing what he wants to do. And he's given us, our ministers and pastors, an opportunity to reach folk that otherwise may never step inside of a church building. But they'll sit at home and they'll scroll through their phone and see who's on and who they might be able to want to listen to. So we got to be real careful in making sure that when we're on live, that we're telling folk about the love of Jesus. Because we got to be folk that they're tired of being beaten down and put down. But we have to let them know that in spite of it all, that if God can save a wretch like us, even us that are here today, that he has this room and hope for every one of you out there. If you're lost, you can turn to him. It's not too late. My God, so turn to him. And we'll come back more with that on the sermon. Amen? So, but please be sure to join us tomorrow at 6 p.m. for our Bible study. And even with that, we ask you to give us you can type in your prayer requests, and then we give those to our, usually sign a prayer book at our Bible study. But if you type in your prayer request. You didn't have to say what it's about. Just give us the name. And we give it to our Mother Shirley, who is a prayer warrior. And some other prayer warriors here in our church. Give them those names and they pray over you. And we've seen miraculous things happen. Even in 2020, God is still working miracles. Amen. We also want to remind you, please join in to our YouTube page. We need about 50 more people. No, about 45 at this point to join in so we can go live on YouTube as well as Facebook. And we're also going to be on Instagram on next Friday night. I'll be on with Minister Apostle Robin Wilson out of Los Angeles, California. She asked me to be her special guest speaker on next Friday night. That'll be 8 o'clock our time here in Louisiana and 6 o'clock California time. So those of you in LA that's listening to us today, please join in on next Friday night when we're going to be with Apostle Robin Wilson talking to the millennials. Let them know that God have not forgotten about you either. Amen, amen. Because so many of our young folk are feeling like they're just lost. They have no hope. But that's because of how some of us adults have beat them down. And then we act like we ain't never did nothing wrong. But I'll be the first to tell you, only but by the grace of God am I here. If God can save a wretch like me with my raggedy life, then I tell everybody there's room for you. So don't y'all stop telling and acting like you've been holy all your life. Ain't never sinned, ain't never did nothing wrong. You're alive. And you're not winning anybody. But when you can tell somebody where God brought you from, God, then they give them hope that if he did it for you, then they can do it for me. Amen. Somebody ought to be glad today that it ain't too late to give God the glory. Amen. I believe that is all. Oh, let me make sure I announce this. If you want to pay or send in your tithes, as I said, and Shirley is outside still with the communion and with the basket. And we got somebody over there close by her too, so you can't come drive through and run off with it. Amen. So I want y'all to thank, you know, because the enemy listening to. Amen. But if you want to send it through Cash App, you can send it to the $CLC, all capital letters, Slidell with a capital S, and then the number 1. And you can send your tithe and offerings in that way. They wanted me to make sure that I let you know that. Again, that's capital CLC, capital S, Slidell, number 1. And it goes straight into the bank. Also, if you don't have that kind of access, you want to do it old school and go through the snail mail, well, you can send it to P.O. Box 6052, Slidell, Louisiana. And the zip code is 70469. Amen.
Amen.
I believe that is all of our announcements at this time. If I forgot something, please charge it to my head, not to my heart. Because we're trying to do this and keep you engaged. We don't want to get too bored with and too long-winded with announcements. This time, we have a special treat for you today. Our senior, who should have graduated on yesterday, and she's here today, and we thank God for her because also Christian Love just started and formed a scholarship fund. And Jaira, being our only senior this year, has been the recipient.
Yay!
Amen. Of that scholarship. Yay! Amen. We thank God for God giving the vision. And I love when he gives the vision to people who ain't looking for a pat on the back.
Right.
But this young lady who wanted to start the scholarship is starting it with $500 is what we're going to be able to bless Jaira with. And then on next year, amen, whatever students we have, we're going to start it with $500 again. And then we're going to add to that. So if we have other seniors next year, then we'll be able to give everybody a little bit of something. Amen? Amen. But this, and we also have someone who is going to follow Jaira while she's in school. Amen. Not just forget about her, send her off, but to look after her, call her, check on her, make sure them grades are staying up, and every now and then send a little blessing her way. But Jaira, you'll see why, because Jaira's report card was all A's and 1B, I believe, right? My God. But anyway, God has gifted this young lady, and even though she didn't get to graduate yesterday, she said, yes, Cousin Steve, I'll be at church tomorrow. I will dance for the Lord, and she is going to come and bless us in her own way right now. And we thank God for her, because this young lady, when she dances for the Lord, you can feel the anointing and the Spirit of God all in the room. And I know she's going to bless you in your house. like she's going to bless us in this house on today. Come on, child, in your own way, baby.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Somebody need to hear that today. When the doctor said yes, you said yes. When the doctor said no, you said yes. And he's still performing. Thank you, Lord. Even though some of us might not get healed on this side, I'm told on the other side, we're going to have brand new bodies. No more diabetes. No more high blood pressure. No more aches. No more crying. My God. You made a way. And I don't know how. Away. My God. Thank you, Lord. Somebody needed that. Thank you, John. My God. You made a way. Out of nowhere. Still making ways. He is a way maker. Oh, bless your name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. If you can, turn the Bible, please, to 1 Peter. Chapter 1, verse 2. One verse that has so much in it. My God. And wherever you are, even at home, you can stand with us. Stand for the reading of the Word of God in obedience to His Word. 1 Peter, the first chapter, verse number 2. And it says, God the Father knew you and chose you long ago. And His Spirit has made you holy. As a result, you have obeyed Him and have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. May God give you more and more grace and peace. You may be seated. The word of the Lord is already blessed. My God. This morning we're going to consider how we've been chosen, changed, and cleansed by God. And to focus our thoughts, I want us to start with a single verse from a letter that was written by Apostle Peter to the followers of Christ who were living in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. And for those of us who are not great on biblical geography, that is roughly the area that we know today as Turkey. And Peter was writing to Christians and believers who had been scattered far from home, some because of persecution, some because of circumstance. Peter was writing to encourage the people who were lonely, sounds like us today, afraid and discouraged. And these words that Peter wrote so long ago are an encouragement, as I read it, even to somebody on today, even during this pandemic. Listen to the words that Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 2 says, God the Father knew you and chose you long ago, Jaira, way before you got to be a senior in high school. And He knew you and chose you long ago, and His Spirit has made you holy. And as a result, you have obeyed Him and have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. May God give you more and more grace and peace. You can't ask for nothing more. But there are three things I want to just draw to your attention this morning. The first one is God the Father chose you. The second one is God the Holy Spirit changes you. And then number three, God the Son cleanses you. First, God the Father chose you. If you look at Ephesians 1 and 4, it tells us, even before He made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in His eyes. Not in man's eyes, but in His eyes. And that's an amazing verse because we have been chosen, you have been chosen, I have been chosen. Chosen because of God's love for us. And even before He made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in his eyes. God has chosen us. We are special to him. We belong to his family, and we are children of the living God. God the Father knew you and chose you long ago. In other words, he means for us to be set apart, chosen before, elect, selected. You see, God is eternal, and he knows the end from the beginning and everything that's going to happen in between. Nothing comes to a surprise by God. He knew you from the start of the time as we know and understand time. And he loved you and chose you to be his very own. I heard my father preach a sermon a long time ago called, I Was Picked Out to Be Picked On. Because God chose those whom he knew would believe and trust in him. God has given us free will. But yet he also knew who would willingly repent and who would willingly turn to him in all things, especially in our salvation. Because God is sovereign, y'all. He knew who would believe him. He knew who would know their need of a Savior. Looking like somebody like myself, he knew who would have faith in the Messiah that he was sent. He knew who would turn to Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. God the Father knew everything and everyone even before he spoke the universe into existence. You and I and all who have faith in him, in the one true and living God, are loved and chosen to be the people of God. 2 Timothy 2:19 reminds us, God's truth stands firm like a foundation stone with this inscription on it. The Lord knows those who are his.
Yes,
and all who belong to the Lord must turn away from evil. So if you are a believer today, this morning, if you have repented of your sin and trusted in Jesus as your Lord, then you have been loved and chosen by God.
Yes,
we are saved by God's love and his mercy. We are set free from the penalty of our sin, and we are assured, oh God, of a place in heaven, all because God's love for us. That's good news, church, because he deserves all the glory for his wonderful plan of salvation. Choosing to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior changed our lives.
Yes.
And those who knows our past and knows how we were and what we used to be, they may think that right now, because we've been changed, we might be a little odd. And as some Christians do. Do you know anyone who thinks that you are a little strange now since you are standing on the Lord's side? Perhaps a little bit odd. You see, when we chose to follow Christ, our lives became different. Perhaps for some of us, subtle differences. And then for some of us, it was a radical change. Ah, God. So think about it. Are you odd in the eyes of the world? If you are, you're in a good place. I read the other day the preacher and the author A.W. Tozer wrote these words. He said, a real Christian is an odd number anyway. He feels supreme love for one he has never seen. He talks every day to someone he cannot see. He expects to go to heaven on the virtue of what someone else did. He empties himself in order that he might be filled. He admits he is wrong so he can be declared right. He goes down in order to get up. He is strongest when he is weakest. He is richest when he is poorest. He is happiest when he feels the worst. I'm talking about the believer. He dies so he can live. He forsakes in order to have. And he gives away so he can keep. Our God. He hears or he sees the invisible. He hears the inaudible. And he knows that which passes knowledge of all understanding. I'm talking about the child of God who can go through and look like you're happy even when everybody else knows you messed up. Pull up from the floor, but you still have a smile on your face. Why? Because you serve a God who helps you to see beyond your circumstance. I'm pleased that I'm a little odd. Well, maybe more than just a little. We are in this world, but as followers of Christ, we are meant to be, not be of this world. Remember the prayer that Jesus prayed in John 17, verse 14 and 18. He said, I have given them your word, and the world hates them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I'm not asking you, Father, to take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. They do not belong to this world and any more than I do. Make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word. This is Jesus talking to the Lord, which is truth. Just as you sent me into the world, Jesus said, I am sending you into the world. Well, I have to stop and say, well, who are them that he's talking about in this prayer? Well, them are the disciples of Christ. Them are you and me. God has chosen you for a purpose. God has a plan for you. You have a reason and you have a destiny. So if you are in the world and not of the world, we make different choices. We live differently. We act differently. Because God has chosen us and we have chosen Christ. Odd, because usually on a Sunday morning we're in church instead of at the casino or playing or watching football or basketball. But you've learned now to put your trust and put God first. COVID-19 have caused some of y'all not to have any other choice but to lean on him. Because you ain't got no sport to watch. Some of us ain't even got a job to go to. We put all everything else was before God. God said, let me put the brakes on. Remind y'all who you're supposed to be serving. Giving you a chance to be alone with yourself. And spend some time with God. And then that helps some of us turn back to God. I'm so glad that he's able to help keep our mind stayed on him. My God. So if you're odd, because instead of having a lie or in a lay-in Sunday morning, you're willing to get up and get dressed and like today, tune in since you can't come in and listen to the song and see the dancing of gyro, people like that, and listen to the fat bald head guy preach telling you about the word of God. Well, the second point I want to make is that God the Holy Spirit changes you.
Amen.
God the Father knew you and chose you long ago, and his spirit has made you holy. The NIV says it like this: sanctified by the work of the Spirit. The Oxford Dictionary defines sanctified as set apart, declared holy, consecrated, free from sin, and purified. As disciples of Christ, we are set apart for God's purposes in this world. And at the moment we give our lives to Christ, at the very moment we give our life to him, we're saved. But there is an ongoing process with this salvation, this change, this sanctification that continues to live in our lives. And it's because God says every day he'll give us brand new mercies. Because you're going to mess up. So if you find a church and everybody in that church, my daddy told me this a long time ago, everybody in there saved and full of the Holy Ghost and don't none of them do no wrong, he said, don't you join that church because you're going to mess it up. He said, and little do they know they already messed up if they believe that they are all wrong. Because the last time I read, the Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory. But I know some of y'all think and say y'all have sinned. Well, he commands us in 1 Peter 1:16. He says, you must be holy because I am holy. I read that sanctification is not my idea of what I want God to do for me. But sanctification is God's idea of what he wants to do for me. My God. The Holy Spirit helps us to be obedient to God. The Holy Spirit works in us. He helps us to focus on God's plans and purpose for us. The Holy Spirit also reminds us that we belong to God. Y'all, the Holy Spirit is somebody. And I hate when I hear people say it, because the Holy Spirit ain't an it, he's a person. God, the Holy Spirit reminds us that we're chosen by God. The Holy Spirit can also change and transform us. But here's the question for you. Do you allow the Holy Spirit to change you?
Okay.
I mean, really change you. Do you allow him to change your thoughts, change your actions, change your words? Do you ever make choices based on what you want or what you know that God expects of you? Do you allow God some control or full control of your life?
Look out.
The Holy Spirit makes us holy. His presence is meant to change us. He can empower each and every one of us to live the lives that bring honor and glory to God. His character and holiness of God is to those that surround us that see your life. So do you want to live a life that reflects the character of holiness of God? Or do you want the Holy Spirit to transform you from the inside out. See, it's easy to act like you say you want to be cleaned up on the outside. And you can fool people. You know, because you are churchy looking. But on the inside, your heart is torn and ragged because you're full of deceit. But in Romans 12, the Apostle Paul encouraged us to let our bodies be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. He says, this is truly the way to worship God. So he says to us, don't copy the behavior and the customs of the world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. The Apostle Peter reminds us that a Christian is someone who has been set apart, someone who is being made holy, someone who is consecrated for God's purposes. My God, friends, each of us, we need the Holy Spirit every day of our life. And he brings daily change in our lives to make us holy, to help us live and lead and guide us, to strengthen and empower us is what the Holy Spirit's job is. Here's number three, and I'm done. The third point I want to make is God the Son cleanses us.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. God the Father knew you and chose you long ago. His Spirit made you holy. And as a result, you have obeyed him and have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Peter tells us because we have been set apart by our obedience to God, we have been cleansed by the blood of Christ. So the obedience that Peter is writing about is continuous obedience. That's living our lives as children of God and disciples of Jesus. Casual, convenient Christianity is not obedience to God. God wants each and every one of us to be wholehearted, not half-hearted. I tell Christian love all the time, God ain't looking for a part-time lover. God wants us to be faithful, not faithless, because it's about commitment. My question to you today, if you're listening and tuning in, are you committed? Even though you're not in the church building, well, that will really show if you're really saved. But see, it's easy for us to come inside these four walls and act holy. But now that you're out there on your own, living in your own house, are the folk in your house seeing you living holy? If we are honest with ourselves and with God, each of us know that there have been times in the past when we chose our way over God's way. Times when we took the easy option rather than the right option.
Right.
Times when instead of standing firm and striving for what God expected and desired of us, we fell short. Saints, obedience to God is not an optional extra. It is meant to be the way we live our daily lives. It was once said that the very nature of the obedience God demands is that it be given without regard to circumstances or results. That means we got to serve him in good times, in bad times, in happy times, sad times. We got to serve him on sunny days as well as rainy days. In everything that we experience, we are to seek and follow God's will and his purpose for our lives. You have obeyed him and have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus. In Old Testament times, people were sprinkled with some blood of an animal. And that was the solemn vow to God. And their great promises to him. But it was a covenant, a relationship, a contract, an agreement. But in the new covenant, God has established with us through the perfect sacrifice of his son, Jesus. Through Jesus, we are cleansed. We are set apart. And we pledge to be obedient. When we turn to Jesus as Lord and Savior, when we repent from our sins and ask God to forgive us of our sin, faith in Jesus, that let us know that we're saved. Our sins, our past, present, and future are forgiven. Why? Because Jesus shed his blood on the cross. He paid the price. A price that we could not pay. He died in our place. Our punishment was put upon him. And through him, we are given righteousness. If you are in Christ this morning, you have already been cleansed, washed, and born again. That's enough to just say praise God right there. Consider this for a moment. When you ask Jesus to be your Savior, you enter into a covenant with God. Jesus has given his life for you. You are meant to be giving your life back to him. Have you done that though? Have you really done that? Are you living a life that demonstrates to God and to others that you have given your life to the Savior, you've been forgiven. You've been cleansed. But are you truly living a life of obedience to God? Is your life, is your life and my life, is it fully set apart for Him? He was washed, He has washed away the penalties of every one of our sins with His blood. We've been bought with a price. Our lives are not our own. God has saved us, and the Holy Spirit lives within us. It should be evident then that in your everyday walk, listen to the words of Apostle Paul in Romans 5. He says, therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ, our Lord, has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand. And we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. He says we can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, because we know that they help us to develop endurance. And endurance develops strength of character, and character strength of confidence, hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead us to disappointment. Why? Because we know how dearly God loves us. Because He has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with His love. When we were utterly helpless, God, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. Now, most people would not be willing to die for even an upright person. Though someone might perhaps be willing to die for a person who is especially good. But God showed His great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were yet sinners. Yeah. While we were still in our sins, He sent His Son. And so since we've been given and made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, He will certainly save us from God's condemnation. For since our friendship with God was restored by death of His Son, while we were still His enemies, we will certainly be saved through the life of His Son. Here's the last verse. It says, so now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God. Why? Because God, our Lord Jesus Christ, has made us friends of God. I'm a friend of God. How about you? The reason I know I'm a friend of God, because He calls me friend. What a friend we have in Jesus. My God. God the Father chose you, God the Holy Spirit changes you, and God the Son cleanses you.
My God.
Have you asked the Holy Spirit to change you? Have you asked Jesus to come in and cleanse you from your sin?
Please.
If you are in Christ, you are chosen, changed, and cleansed. God loved you then, if you did that, but loves you now and will continue to love you. Why? Because despite of our faults, I love this. Despite of our imperfections, God knows you and He loves you. God loves you. He called you, He selected you, and He has a plan for you. I don't want to talk to you out there today, but God wants you to know that He wants you to discover the destiny that He has ordained in your life. The Holy Spirit lives in you. He has changed you, is changing you, and will continue to work in you and through you. Jesus died for you. Jesus has saved you. He has cleansed you. The sacrifice of Jesus has set us free from the penalty of sin. So therefore, Jesus is now both my Savior and my Lord. May God help us to become the people that He called us to be. Chosen, changed, cleansed, and committed. Committed to discovering your destiny. Can anybody in here today or anybody that's listening today say that I give myself away so you can use me? Lord, come into my heart. Stay with me. Can you thank Him for dying for you? For setting us and making us free? You got to tell Him, God, I love you. I love you more than anything. I need you. There's no way I can make it without you. Why? Because you are my strength. Strength like no other. And it reaches, oh God, to me every day. Even when I fall. Even when I fail you. Your word says you will never leave me nor forsake me. If you don't remember anything else, remember that verse from today. First Peter 1 and 2. God the Father knew you.
Yes, sir.
Chose you long ago.
Thank you, man.
And his spirit has mercy. He loved me so much.
Yes, sir.
That he gave me another chance. He'll do the same thing for you. If you trust him, you just have to believe. With every head bowed, with every eye closed. I don't know who this is for today, but if God is speaking to your heart and he's telling you, and you know that your back is against the wall. You've done and tried everything that you know how to do. But you're saying, God, I don't know where else to turn. He's saying to you then, I'm right here. All you have to do is surrender. He said, I've already died and paid for your sins. All you have to do now is open your mouth and confess that you believe in me and that you believe that I died for your sins. He said, if you believe that in your heart, confess it with your mouth, you shall be saved. If that is you today, you can start a brand new life right now. You don't have to worry or fear anymore where you're going to spend eternity. Because he said, if you're a child of the king, the devil in hell can't pluck you out of his hands. Then you'll be able to stand boldly like the rest of us who are believers and say, I love you, Jesus. Just want to tell you how much I love, worship, and adore you. If that is you today, you've been saved. You've been forgiven. You don't have to let the enemy talk to you or trick you any longer, making you think you're not worthy enough of God's love. He's telling you right now, I love you. I love you more than anything. And you got to tell him that back. All these blessings I pray and I ask in the mighty name of Jesus. For every lost soul that have tuned in with us today and have not made a commitment to God, today is your day to give your life back to Christ. That's all you have to do is repent of your sin. It's that simple. You don't have to fall out and roll in the floor and foam at the mouth, any of those things. All you have to do is simply say, Lord, I need you. I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. And I believe that you died for me. If you really believe that, he said you're already saved. It's that simple. Then you can just tell him, adoration to you. Why? Because you reign on the throne. On the throne. For you are God and God alone. Because of you, my cloudy days, they're gone. I can sing to you this song. I just want to say that I love you more than anything else. Wrap me in your arms. You are my shelter from the storm. When all my friends were gone, you were right there all alone. I never knew a love like this before. I love you more than you. Come on and say it with me. I love you, Jesus. Hey, God.
Hallelujah.
I worship and adore you. Just want to tell you, Lord, I love you more than anything. Word of God, where you can live out your soul salvation, giving your life back to Christ, telling him how much you love him. Thank you for joining us. Please join us again tomorrow at 6 p.m. for our Bible study. God bless you. Until the next time we meet again.